And welcome to worship at Metropolitan Community Church of Richmond. We're so glad that you're here to join us for our time of worship together as we give thanks for the goodness of God's amazing love, which continues to transform our realities. I want to say that I deeply appreciate all that happened so that Kirk and I could vacation during from Christmas until New Year's Day. It was really strange not to be in church on Christmas Eve and Christmas morning. And I figured out that was the first time for me in 35 years. Now, I know some of you are shocked that I'm that old. I know Calvin just gave the But I can tell you that as soon as we loaded up our dogs, our car, and our food, and we started heading to the Greenbrier Mountain in West Virginia, I was not thinking so much about being in church, but thinking about how wonderful it was going to be in the snow and to do hiking and to spend time with family. It was amazing, and I'm feeling rested and ready for action this morning. So get ready. Hold on to your socks or your slippers, whatever the point may be. If you're worshiping with us at home, we give thanks for each and every one of you. And I pray and hope that as you enjoy coffee or relaxing in your own environment, that you will sense the spirit of God's love and God's presence. We invite you at home to get a little glass of juice or a cracker, or a piece of bread, or maybe even a Christmas cookie or a piece of cake. So that you can participate with us in the receiving of the Holy Meal later, and also to get a little candle so when Georgia comes to lead us in our gathering that we can build community with one another as we light candles. I want you to know that last week I had the wonderful opportunity of being late to worship. You say, how could this be? Well, it's because I was eating and I started to read a magazine that I received over Christmas, and you'll be so glad to know that it was a magazine that talked about the life of Ruth Bader Ginsburg, and I was enthralled. And Nancy said to me, isn't it church time? And I was like, oh my goodness. But this morning, before I get to what I'm going to say, I want to show you this wonderful gift that I received. Sean's going to put it in front of the camera. It is an ornament with Ruth Bader Ginsburg dissent collar on it, and it says, I dissent. And so now I have an ornament to lead as we stand up and speak up and share our truth with people. And I encourage you to do the same thing. So last week, I watched our service on my phone. And let me tell you what, it was absolutely beautiful to be able to be relaxed at the table and listening to each and every one of you. The music was fantastic. Thank you, Jenny and your team. The framing of the service, the picture that you see was fabulous. So thank you, social media team. And I want to tell you something that I learned. If there were times that I needed to turn the volume up on my phone so that I could hear the service better, sometimes there are things that happen in the internet that we cannot control. So this morning, if you have an issue with sound, please be responsible for your own device by turning up the sound. Let us know if the sound goes out. But I want to give a big shout out to Mo for all that she did to make sure that we had sound last week. It was remarkable to worship through my iPhone. And for those of you that know that I am technically challenged, you'll really understand how brilliant that is. Thank you, Sean. We had amazing attendance at our Christmas Eve, Christmas Day, and our service last Sunday. Over 350 people viewed those three services. So we give thanks for that, that we're able to share the message of God's love literally around the world. And from those three services, I received emails from people in the following states or areas. From Nebraska, Minnesota, Texas, Florida, Alabama, North Carolina, South Carolina, California, Nevada, you read my own writing, Las Vegas, West Virginia, Pennsylvania, Washington State, Oregon, Kentucky, Louisiana, Mexico, Wisconsin, Amsterdam. Did you all hear that? Amsterdam. We give a shout out to Will and Maureen for watching. Idaho, Richmond, Henrico, Glen Allen, Short Pump, Chester, Chesterfield. Give yourselves a hand as we celebrate our community. I'm really excited as we today focus on the text for Epiphany. Epiphany is not today. It will happen on Thursday, January 6th. It is the 12 days after Christmas. So we'll be singing to this morning about the Magi and all of that. And I invite you to begin our service with us as we sing together, We Three Kings of Orient Are. That song reminds us to follow the light of Jesus, which will transform our lives each and every moment of each and every day. Amen, church? Amen. Amen. Let us now listen to these words of wholeness by Sharon Wiley and set the intention for our service today as we receive all that God has for us. So I invite you to, wherever you are, to get yourself comfortable, relax, let go of the concerns on your minds. Those things that are driving you crazy, maybe thoughts that you woke up with this morning, questions, wonders, concerns that you have, and allow yourself to open up to the beauty of God's Spirit coming to make manifest to you more of what God has for you in this time that we will share together. Hear these words.
We speak so often of brokenness in religious life. Let us today speak of wholeness. You are welcome here. All of you, welcome here. Every part of you, beautiful, just the way you are. Here you do not need to be something more or something less. No holding back, no hiding, no exerting yourself, no trying to do more or be more, because you have inherent worth and dignity. You have nothing to prove here, nothing to prove to me or to the person sitting next to you or to the children or to anyone. You don't have to try to be more witty or more quiet or more outgoing, because you are beautiful. Every part of you beautiful just the way you are. You do not need to change anything about yourself to be welcome here. Your skin, your hair, your belly, your limbs, your face, all beautiful, beautiful, just the way they are. You are extraordinary, each and every one of you different from each and everybody else. Beautiful in your own beautiful way, because you are created in the image of a loving God. Therefore, you are breathtaking just the way you are. Let us continue to worship in this reality.
Joyful all ye nations rise, Jesus the light of the world. Joy in the triumph of the skies, Jesus the light of
Welcome home, Pastor. And welcome to our friends and family out in our virtual land, and to our loved ones who decided to come into the sanctuary. Let's do this good morning again so we know that I'm not here by myself. Good morning, beloved.
Good morning.
Good morning. Oh, God is so good. So merciful.
All the time.
So staying in that mood of welcomeness, I welcome our first-time visitors as well as our MCC family, and thanking you all for taking time out to share in our worship service this morning. And know from my heart that your presence means so much to me as well as to us who come out into the sanctuary this morning. So last week I had the opportunity to step up to the challenge. Thank you for the challenge, Pastor. And for the opportunity to minister to you. This morning I was given an opportunity to lead our Sunday school class. And every time that we do something, or every time I do something here in the service, I count it as an opportunity, not as a job, because it allows God to use me for the betterment of all humanity. So we form community here in three ways. One, through our greetings, and the other one is through our rua, our practice of breathing, our breath work, and then through the lighting of our Christ candle, which Pastor has already asked you to get a candle to do that when we get to that portion of it. It's not so much about the technical things that we do here, but it's about the spiritual things that we do here. So I greet you from my heart, my spirit, as we say our greeting together. And it reads as such. It doesn't matter who you are, where you've been, or what you've done, how you love, or who you love, God welcomes you, and so do we. You are welcome here. And remaining in that space of welcomeness, I would just, as Pastor had alluded to relax and close your eyes if you choose to, as we just settle our hearts and our minds down to go before, to go within, into our place of safeness, that sanctuary, that temple of oneness with God, to breathe in His presence. So I would ask you to take in a breath, breathing in the goodness, breathing in the knowingness, breathing in the grace of God. We breathe in deeply, filling our lungs with the life-giving source for our body, but also filling our spirits with the life source of all that there is. Now we gently let it out, let it go, release, and letting all those things that would hinder us, all those things that say that we're not good enough, all those things that the world say that we're not, but God says, yes, you are. Now take in the breath, take in truth, take in substance, take in life, the life of God permeating all throughout your body and into the universe. For we are life, for in the beginning was life, and so we are. Now release it gently with joy, knowing that everything that's exiting your body is leaving for your good, that you may be filled with the greater, the better, the goodness of God. Knowing that you are special, you are the transformed, you are truly the beloved. Now let it go and give great thanks for it. And now we light our Christ candle. We light it symbolically outside, and we light it symbolically inside. For we know that we are the lights of the world. We are sparks, rays of hope to someone, someplace, that we are been given this grace. We've been given this gift, this illumination. Light it and let your light shine now and forever. And so it is. Amen.
A newborn king to
Please join me for our communal prayer. For our communal prayer, the first for 2021, I invite you to include the names and the concerns of persons and situations held in heart or in mind. You may speak them aloud or in sacred silence as we enter into the presence of Christ. You may add your names now. And the word reads, behold, the former things are come to pass, and new things do I declare. Let us pray. Holy Abba, creator of all worlds and peoples, we are ever grateful for all your mighty works done in and through us, your creation. We are thankful for the passing of the former things, and thankful for your grace and mercy that kept us throughout this chaotic year. We eagerly look forward to a greater Christ presence operating in our lives for strength and wisdom to meet the challenges and changes this year will bring. Lord, encourage our spirits, equip our hearts to see through the fog of despair and disharmony, to rise above the confusion and mayhem, to see your holy presence always in the midst of all our decisions and activities and the actions of others. Lord, we set our spirits and our hearts to begin this year with a positive, hopeful attitude and a readiness to love and serve that we may be avenues of peace and grace to others and ourselves. Abba, we are thankful for the multitude of prayers answered, the physical, the emotional, spiritual wounds healed, the finances replenished, the relationships mended, and the prayers yet to manifest. We remain in prayer for all those facing food insufficiency, housing eviction, and unemployment. We pray for a resolve to this pandemic, protection for the people giving care to those in need, and comfort to those grieving a loss. Lord, we pray safety for our elderly. Many are alone and isolated in isolation during this period. We pray for the safety and the well-being of our little ones, our children, the innocents. Lord, we thank you for the hearing of our many words. The affirmation said in the prayer's requests, we release it all in the name, the nature of our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, and let the church say, amen, amen and amen.
His name is called. To God be the glory for the great things that God has done in 2020, and for the better things that God's going to do in 2021. Good morning, church, and Happy New Year. 4 weeks ago, we started our last fundraiser for the year, in which we entitled Christmas, A Gift of Love. You donated $4,055 to that fund. Spectacular. $4,055. That's the power of community. $4,055. That's the power of God at work. So on behalf of Pastor Kenny, the board of directors, and the fundraising team, we say thank you. Thank you for your generosity, thank you for your love, and thank you for your commitment. Happy New Year, church.
Good morning. Today's reading comes from Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. After Jesus' birth, which happened in Bethlehem of Judea, during the reign of Herod, astrologers from the east arrive in Jerusalem and ask, "Where is the newborn ruler of the Jews? We observe his star at its rising and have come to pay homage." At this news, Herod became greatly disturbed, as did all of Jerusalem, summoning all the chief priests and religious scholars of the people. He asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem of Judea," they informed him. "Here's what the prophet has written. And you, Bethlehem, land of Judah, are by no means least among the leaders of Judah, since from you will come a ruler who is to shepherd my people, Israel." Herod called the astrologers aside and found out from them the exact time of the star's appearance. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, actually, after having instructed them, "Go and get detailed information about the child. When you have found him, report back to me so that I may go and offer homage too." After their audience with the ruler, they set out. The star, which they have observed at its rising, went ahead of them until he came to a standstill over the place where the child lay. They were overjoyed at seeing the star, and upon entering the house, found the child with Mary, his mother. They prostrated themselves and paid homage. Then they opened their coffers and presented the child with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Then they were warned in a dream not to return to Herod, so they went back to their own country by another route. May God bless the hearing of these words.
I really like the way that Les reads scripture, don't you? Thank you, Les. But I really like the way that Miss Ricky tells us about money. I love it. And one of the things I appreciate about Ricky's leadership of the fundraising team is that she's not afraid to ask. She's not afraid to ask for money. She's not afraid to do things differently. She's not afraid to say, "Well, what do you think about this? What do you think about that?" And to let the fundraising team massage whatever fundraisers are gonna have. So I wanna thank you, Ricky, for your leadership because you are amazing. Amazing. And I want to thank each and every one of you for giving to the fundraisers, because it's just, again, the realization that we cannot outgive God, right? All that we do when we give is we present back to God a portion of the gifts that God has given us. And that is the message of living our faith. That is the message that we as a spiritual community get to realize and live each and every day. And that is what these magi, the astrologers, or the wise ones gave as they came into the presence of the Holy Child. They didn't have to think about, "Well, let me go online and see what's on sale. Let me see what's going on with Amazon. What kind of coupon can I use? They gave from what they had. And what an amazing witness that is. And I believe that we at MCC Richmond do this in many, many ways. We give of ourselves. We give of our time. We give of our talents. We give of our financial resources in the hope that when we give and do these things, that the message of God's love can be shared with others, and that makes a difference. Amen? Amen. The word epiphany is a revelation. It means an awakening. It comes from the Greek word that is translated as revealing, a manifestation of the divine. We call this season the season of epiphany because it's the season of light. It's the season that this burst of gold glitter, which you know I love, reminds us of, that it is the light of a star in the east that led these astrologers, the magi, the wise ones, whatever you want to call them. And by the way, the scriptures does not say there were three. There were probably many, because they're like, what in the world is going on? We gotta see what this is about. If something happens in your neighborhood or your community that is beyond your comprehension, you're going to sit back and just let it happen? Heaven's sake, you're like me. You want to go there and check it out, see what's going on. So these wise ones went to check it out, and what they found was this star that led the way gave us the reality that God is doing something new, that Jesus would be and is the light of the world. And that means the whole world, not some of the world, not some people, but Jesus is the light of the whole world. And that's the connection between Epiphany and the story of the Magi or astrologers in today's sacred text from Matthew's story. This story is filled with wonder and magic of the wandering people that led them to Jesus. People who went to find out where Jesus was, where Jesus lay. And I think they came up with amazing implications of what the birth of this holy child, Jesus, would mean. Even more, the Magi witnesses to the commitment of God to reach the whole world with the news of God's redeeming and transforming love. We love this story in part because of the mystery of these few people that went out to find the Holy Child, to be led by this star, and what it means for us. Because a story is only a story, but it becomes relevant when we can apply the story to our own lives. And so as you begin to think about what this story might mean for you, I would ask you also to consider what it is that God brings to your life that is new and wonderful through God's love. And what gifts do you have that you know are given to you from the divine so that you can offer them back to Jesus? And we offer them back as we reach out for people in our community, some that are hurting, some that need to be loved up, some who just need to know they have a friend. And also, as we treat our family members with dignity and respect, even those family members or friends that drive us a little bit cuckoo at times, right? But there's another aspect of this story that we cannot overlook that I believe can get lost in the shuffle if we only think about the gifts that the Magi bring, or that it's about these Magi on a journey, and that is the level of fear and opposition that Jesus' birth brings right from the beginning. Think about that. What is it about Jesus' birth that could bring fear and opposition? It's about this character named Herod. Because did you notice that Herod does not greet the news of a newborn ruler with joy and excitement?
He did not look for a gift to present to the Messiah. Rather, Herod becomes afraid. And just not Herod, but all of Jerusalem with him. I didn't make this up. This is what the text says. So you know I'm going to push it as well as I can. Because why would Herod get so upset? Why would Herod and all of the people in Herod's court get so twisted about the birth of the Holy Child? My hunch is that it would challenge their power. Oh, now let's get into it. Perhaps the one thing that the powerful seek more than anything else is to what? To remain in power. Whatever that might mean or whatever the reality might be, this story in Matthew's text shows us that holding on to power makes us afraid of losing it, of losing power and control. Therefore, from the text, we could assume that Herod has lost any notion of the kind of servant leadership that is prescribed and required by the Israel prophets. Gone is the memory that God had placed them in their positions to serve rather than to what? Be served. Herod becomes self-absorbed and self-seeking and is immediately threatened by any mention of another, and I would say therefore rival ruler. Now, church, think about our own current affairs. Does this sound familiar to any of you? Oh, you know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm talking about. But perhaps the presence of these magi and their quest of God's Messiah announce also that the world is changing, that God is approaching in a new way. What did we say all during the season of Advent? That we would prepare ourselves to open ourselves up for God to come in new ways. And this is why. Because when we realize and sense that God is doing something in our lives, we realize that nothing can remain the same. And I would be willing to stand up here and say to you that in the presence of God's Messiah, nothing is ever the same. And to that, y'all should be saying, amen. Because God makes a difference in our lives. And that main difference is God will go to any lengths to help us realize that we are loved just the way we are. So what this story helps us remember is that God's loving embrace is much more far-reaching than what we could ever imagine. And certainly in the day in which this text was written, God's love had not been imagined in that because God was coming in a new way. And this new way would to be bring the reality that in God, there is never an insider and an outsider. Never insider and outsider. But all are included in God's loving embrace. That's why it's important for us to go out of our way as people of faith to help people understand that no one is ever left out in God's world, period. Now, the truth of the matter is that doesn't mean that we're always going to like the behaviors of others. We are not asked to like people. What we're asked is to love them the way that God loves them. Ooh, there you go. That causes us and calls us to a higher level. I think that whatever the realities that Herod and his court was going through, whatever realities we go through, one thing I know is that when we experience fear, that is a powerful manifestation in our lives. Because fear, just like Herod and the chief priests and scribes, causes us sometimes to do the unthinkable. Causes us to treat people differently, causes us to beat up on ourselves, when we are embracing fear for whatever reason, we do things that we would never do. We sometimes drink too much. We put ourselves in situations that are dangerous. We treat other people with disrespect. We're not concerned about telling the truth, because what we get concerned with is saving face, is making sure that our status is still okay. And we live in this illusion that things are going to be okay. But the truth of the matter is, things are never okay when you're living in fear, because fear makes us tell one lie and then another and then another. And before you know it, the deception is so thick because of fear that we don't even know who we are. We don't even know who we are. And I would say that's one of the reasons that God sent the Divine One, to show us that we are enough, to show us that when we are riddled with fear, that God understands that. And that God will send people to help us rid ourselves of fear. That God will help us to chip away at our fear in ways that are not degrading, but in ways that we can be free of the things that that fear has brought. And you know as well as I know that this is constant work. Fear is not let go of in a day's time. It is a journey, but it is a journey that God will meet us on, and God will send people into our lives to help us rid ourselves of that fear. The other thing that I think was happening for Herod, that happens for us as well, is that the world was changing. It's that word change, the C word, that few of us enjoy. Now, I have to admit that I am a person that enjoys change, because I know that change brings realities that help us to experience the world differently, that help us to be intrigued by what might be around the next corner. But I am not one that enjoys change for its change's sake, but change with a purpose. And so as we think about the realities of the Nativity, this change that God is bringing into our lives is the love that we experience through the ministry of Jesus. The love that we experience as we, as people of faith, people within a spiritual community, try to mirror with one another. Change to help other people grow. Change helps us to experience the divine, the holiness that is within each and every one of us, and to bring that out in one another in new ways. And you cannot change if you're, first of all, not able to be honest about your fear. You cannot change if you're not able to be honest about your fear. And so this morning, I would ask you to think about, how do you respond to fear and change? Do you frantically search for ways to show others, oh, I'm okay, I'm just fine, I'm just fine? And you know, when you get this fine face on, people are like, ooh, that child's a mess. That child's a mess, right? Or do you need to emotionally protect yourself when your power is shaken, when you feel that there's some status that you might be losing? Do you need to demean others and talk about them and put them down? Or do you need to run away when your feelings get hurt out of fear and change? Or are you a person that instead needs to blame others for your reality instead of taking responsibility for your life and allowing God to help you be more of the person that you want to be? I think sometimes we close our hearts and we close our minds to the healing, to the newness of life that God brings us, not on a daily basis, I would say moment by moment. Amen? Amen. Because God wants us to be free of the things that drive us crazy, that cause us to question ourselves, that cause us to question others, to cause us not to be able to trust, to cause us to think that we are God. 2020 brought us an abundance of reason to fear, and a lot of change happened in our world. Practically everything we do as individuals and as a spiritual community had to change. And we together experienced a lot of fear. We had doubts and lots of questions about 2020. And you know, the good news about MCC Richmond is that we experienced these feelings together. We didn't have answers. We still don't. But you know what? This past year, we have survived, and we have done more than survived. We have thrived as a congregation because we allowed ourselves to be present for what God had for us as we experienced 2020. So I say that 2020 brought us an abundance of opportunities as individuals and as a congregation to grow. To grow. 2020 brought us opportunities to be involved in ministry, in ministry and advocacy. 2020 taught us to tell people, can you please social distance so that I can be safe and therefore you can be safe. And by the way, please put your mask up over your nose. Little things. But these were things that changed our reality. 2020 brought us, MCC Richmond, an opportunity to revision ministries, existing ministries, some ministries that we had done the same old for years, like worship. Oh my goodness, who would have thought that we would be broadcasting worship through the internet and that lives would be touched in all of these states? And let me tell you, as I receive your emails each and every week, I love reading them. What I love the most is hearing that people could not believe that God would love them just the way they are. A transgender person, and people that have hidden from their families, parents who say to me, I don't know what to say to my gay children. And I say to them, tell them you love them. Tell them you love them. People that are in drunken stupors when they start an email and then for some reason they sober up enough to hear my response, thinking that they have to drink their life away. This is what fear and change will do to us. But we have not let fear and change drive us crazy. We have let fear and change bring us into a reality of trusting that God would be with us. Trusting that we would do great things, because that's what happens when we open ourselves up to the divine. These are opportunities to make a difference in people's lives. And I believe that we have. Have they been easy? No. Many of the ministry opportunities that we've had this year have been opportunities that we have entered into people's realities. Sitting with somebody who is dying, helping someone understand a diagnosis, helping someone get medication, making sure that people get meals, making sure that people get a bath, making sure that worship happens, making sure that we understand how to use Zoom so that we can still connect with one another. We have experienced through the Vicki Hester Food Pantry expansion of that ministry that we could have not imagined without the help of COVID-19. Without the help of COVID-19. When did you think that besides the people that receive food downstairs each and every week in the celebration hall, that we would have people that would deliver boxes of food to people who cannot get out because they do not have a car? That's the reality at MCC Richmond. Who would have thought that neighbors that we didn't see as our friends because of the behavior of a few? When did we think that we would see these neighbors bring food to us each and every day? It is not uncommon to have bags and boxes of food left at the church office or at our entrance to the celebration hall. Sean's shaking his head because he gets to take all that food downstairs. And we give thanks for that. So church, may we embrace the good news that the light of Jesus brings into our lives. May we step into our reality of our God consciousness as we let the light of Christ continue to lead us just the way we are. But as we let the light of Christ lead us, may we also be open to the change that Jesus brings to our world and not be afraid. Not be afraid. Not to be motivated by fear. Not to be afraid. But to stand up and to take stock of the blessings of God. To know that God is with us always. That when we see something as impossible, that's only a bigger reality for God to do the impossible, impossible in our lives. Just like they said to me, you could never do fundraising at a church. You could never do a food pantry at a church. I got news for you. Tell me I can't. And we'll see how God gets busy. Because I'm just that much of a dissenter, don't you know? Because I know, I know what it's like to be riddled with fear, but I also know what it's like to be changed from the inside out. And so may we see ourselves not as outsider or insider, but know that God will come in and change us to be more of those individuals that God desires for us to be. And let us spread our glitter wherever we go with confidence that we are valuable to God and we are valuable to one another. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
MCC Richmond. Whew, I'm tired. I don't know about y'all, but this 2020 has been crazy. Do you know how much you all did this past year?
Yeah.
Let me help you. You gave tons of time and talent. We've had people help out around here in the food pantry with the church office. We've had people help out in the community. We've had people help out in their own home being safe. That's a lot of time and talent. We've also had lots of money come in. Your gifts, your contribution, your tithes, your offerings, a lot that has sustained this church. We are here today for 2021 because of what you did in 2020 despite a global pandemic. Thank you, thank you, thank you, MCC Richmond friends and family. I forgot to say, you also showed up. You engaged. See, there's no reason to give money and time and talent if there's no one to show up. So thank you for showing up too. I thought real quickly about the sermon today and the part of the sacred text of the lectionary. You like that, huh? Pastor Kenny lectionary?
Yeah.
It could have set it up any better for me. The Magi brought gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Very valuable items 2,000 years ago. But then there's the little drummer boy. Thank you for the song, Jenny. I want to remind you real quick, this part of the verse. I am a poor boy too. I have no gift to bring. How many of you feel that way many times? I know I do. But you don't have to have gold, frankincense, and myrrh to contribute to Metropolitan Community Church of Richmond. There are many ways to contribute, and it can be as little as, oh wait, this dollar bill that I happen to have in my wallet. See that? It can be as little as that. And if you don't have that, there are many other things that you can do to contribute. So with that, right now, I invite you to go to mccrichmond.org/giving. Hold on. And you can find many different ways of giving to the church financially. Again, thank you all for your contributions in every way in 2020, your contributions today, and those in the future. God bless you.
As we come now to the holy meal, the center of our worship, let us remember that Jesus is the host of this meal, and Jesus turns absolutely no one away. Come now, just as you are, and experience this sacred time with God. Living as the people of God, let us confess our concerns and shortcomings to God. In silence, we pause for reflection and self-examination. Blessed people of God, through the ministry and life of Jesus, God forgives us, God heals us, and showers us with gifts of love, hope, and grace.
just the way we are and brings us to this feast of victory and life.
The Lord be with you. Oh, come, let us lift our hearts to our God. With hearts uplifted, ring to God we offer. With joy we bless God's name. In gratefulness we worship with thanks. God forevermore. In the many names of our Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer, we embrace all that is holy as we sing together.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, by all adored, heaven and earth cannot contain.
On the night before his betrayal and arrest, Jesus took bread. He gave thanks for the bread, and then he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, Jesus took the cup, and when he had given thanks for the cup, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my love poured out for you and for everyone. Do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, as often as we eat this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the mystery and the victory of our faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ is here, and Christ will come again. Alleluia. In preparation for sharing this meal and mystery, let us say together the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Let us partake. Let's pray. Creator, we give you thanks for the ways that you provide all that we need. Help us when we become riddled with fear to depend on you to help us move through each experience, knowing that we are loved, knowing that you care about us, and knowing that you will provide. And as we experience change, may we also embrace it, knowing that through change, you are drawing closer to us. We pray all of these things in all of your many names, and in everything that is holy, we give you thanks, and we say together, Amen.
Thank you for being here, MCC Richmond. And it's time to go home. Closing time. Okay, so for the coming week, your announcements. I'd ask for a drum roll, but John's away today. First of all, remember to email godguykenny@gmail.com, letting him know from where you watched this service today or later on this week. Speaking of emailing Pastor Kenny, New member class is coming up and we're doing it virtually. Please send him an email or call him, but emails are best, letting him know that you're interested in joining MCC Richmond. By the way, if you have any type of spiritual or pastoral care issues or just want to say, hey, what's up, email Pastor Kenny. More important announcement this week is the new Council of Elders needs to be affirmed by a special general conference. So there was an announcement in the email that went out last Friday that they will hold a virtual forum to provide candidates an opportunity to speak and answer questions. That is UFMCC. So that's on Monday, January 11th at 6 p.m. and then again on Saturday, January 16th at 1 p.m. Those virtual forums, again, will give the Council of Elders candidates an opportunity to speak to the fellowship as a whole. Once that's done, then it goes to the General Conference to affirm after the Board of Directors and Cecilia have already done their thing. MCC Richmond, however, will hold a special congregational meeting on January 17th at 1 p.m. regarding our vote to affirm the Council of Elders through the Special General Conference. For additional details, please go back to your email and check it out, or contact me at the church office, or better yet, get yourself added to the email list. Again on that later. I also want, on behalf of Metropolitan Community Church of Richmond, send a big thank you to Diversity Richmond. This is our second year in a row that they have granted the Vicki Hester Food Pantry, along with this year the Lounge, the Bread Ministry, and our Good Neighbor Fund, a $5,000 grant. Again, this is the second year in a row that we have received that $5,000 grant. I don't know about last year, but this year that is their top grant amount awarded. There was only one other organization that received that amount. So we are very thankful and blessed that Diversity Richmond continues to support the work that we do because they see the work that you do. Emails, emails, emails. Remember to email me at the church office if you have questions about anything unpastor related. I don't do that stuff, but I can help you out in any way I can. Also, if you need to be added to the email list, that is every single one of you watching right now from home. Add yourself to the email list by contacting me. And then finally, if you do need some type of technical assistance connecting with MCC Richmond, whether it be Zoom, this Facebook Live service, please contact me at the church office, and one of the members of the communications team will reach out to you to give you whatever assistance we can. Don't let yourself go by the wayside just because you can't figure it out. We have wonderful tech support people here. So finally, remember, right this minute, as we're walking away, to like us, follow us, subscribe to us, comment, and share us, most importantly, share MCC Richmond on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and YouTube. Take it away with All Will Be Well, someone. Bye.